Welcome back. It's still the Breakfast and Plus TV Africa, and we will be discussing issues bordering, renewed militancy in the Niger Delta. Specifically, a new militant group in Rivers State, Bayan Men, attacked another oil facility belonging to the Nigerian Ajib Oil Company at Obosi area of Omoku, Oba, Emema, Ndoni local government area. And we have joining us Professor Kenneth Nweke. Good morning to you. Many thanks for joining us on the Breakfast on Plus TV Africa.
Good morning, Nigerians.
All right, let's talk about this particular bombing that happened along that particular axis, Obosi area of Omoku in Rivers State. What does this really tell you? Over time, we've had some sort of peace and calm in the Niger Delta, but with this new attack, what are we failing to see?
Well, I don't think there's anything to get worried about, but except the fact that this is appearing new because over time there hasn't been this kind of attack. But I don't think that it's something that would be able to send some kind of panic to Nigerians and the people of Niger Delta. But of course, you know that the level of criminality in Nigeria is gone so high, not just about the other parts of the country, but of course, the Niger Delta region has remained very, very peaceful in the last few years. But again, it actually calls for a review of what the Amnesty Office is doing in the Niger Delta in terms of the post-amnesty programs that that office is handling in the Niger Delta region.
All right, we'll try and reconnect with Professor Nweke there. He seems to be having some issues with his device. In as much as he said it's nothing to really worry about, I just may want to disagree, because they actually bombed that particular facility after the expiration of the ultimatum that they gave to the Nigeria Ajib oil facility. But then again, they are saying that they are not criminals, that they are intellectuals. The fact is that they, when a man, I'm just quoting them verbatim, the fact is that when a man is pushed to the wall, he bounces back with double force. We are giving Ajib another 7 days to open windows of negotiation with the 27 communities of Omoku clan. I don't know if we'll have Professor Nweke back. All right, Mercy, I think it's something we should indeed be worried about, because there has been a relative calm in that area. But with all of this renewed bombing, I don't know, in my opinion, it is actually sending the wrong signals.
Well, first of all, we would have to understand that the Niger Delta region has actually been going through a lot. I mean, the concerns, the fact that the source of livelihood has actually been destroyed over time due to the activities of this international companies, of course, oil exploration and what have you over the years. And the issue of oil, I mean, the principle of derivation, the 13% is still ongoing and what have you. But the concern now would be finding out what the motive is, what actually is the motive. Are we still fighting the same cause? Let's not forget about the fact that this is actually a new group. I mean, this is a new militant group as it is, and it is not, the usual that we know. What cause are they fighting for? Could it be the cause for justice? And I'm also hoping that, Professor Kenneth...
He's back online.
He's back online. All right, Professor Kenneth Nweke.
Yeah, sorry, thank you.
It's good to have you join us back again. So just as I and my colleague were having a banter in the studio, the next question would be, do you think that this is actually a fight for justice, or is just also another means of making money, selfish purpose or interest?
Of course, I don't think it's a fight for justice for the people of Niger Delta. A lot of people have been over time been made to believe that these kind of attacks are meant to address the injustices in the Niger Delta region. But I don't think that this particular one is one that you would want to associate with that kind of struggle for justice in the Niger Delta region. But I think that basically what is happening is part of criminality, the upsurge of criminality in various parts of the country. And so you have the Northeast, you have the Northwest, and then you have the Southwest, you have also the Southeast, and then Of course, the Niger Delta region has been very, very quiet over time. And probably this is another upsurge that we would not want to associate, you know, with the level of injustices that are meted out for the Niger Delta region. I have always said clearly, and I mean, I can be put on record, that yes, it's not enough from what the federal government is doing in the Niger Delta region or the oil multinational. But if we at least are sincere enough that we are able to utilize what is being done for the Niger Delta region from the government and oil companies, then we would have addressed most of the challenges, because a lot of the Niger Delta sons and daughters are part of the NDDC. And then I know that the oil multinationals are giving enough, you know, funding to NDDC in terms of their budgetary provision, particularly budgetary provision. And so we have the Amnesty Office and others. We have the Niger Delta Ministry. And so how have we been able to utilize these resources, even though they are not enough to address the enormity of the challenges? As I speak to you, I come from a community in Igbo in Chief, and so that has this, over 350 oil and gas wells. But from Obibo End to Igbo in Chief in River State, you cannot access the place. It's deplorable. And these are things that can challenge the people into this kind of attack. But I think that, yes, our people have borne so much injustices in the past, also meted out by our own people themselves, you know, because they have been saddled with the responsibility of developing our area, but they have failed to utilize, you know, the little resources that have been accrued, you know, through these agencies, interventionist agencies, in addressing our challenges. But I think that even with this forensic audit report and all that, you know, the government needs to, the federal government needs to put, you know, their feet on the ground to ensure that whoever that is coming as board members of the NDDC actually are genuinely committed to developing the Niger Delta region in line. I mean, I also work in synergy with oil multinationals. As we speak today, SPDC is planning to divert some of the investments that it has in the Niger Delta region. These are some of the signs, you know, that all is not well in the Niger Delta region, and most of the oil and multinationals are not also ready, you know, to do what they ought to do, you know, again, because the little they are doing is not commensurate with what we are getting and all that. So it calls for, you know, a change of heart. But I think that this kind of attack probably is meted out by a few people who actually are looking to feather their individual nest.
Okay, right. But there's also concern that they are saying that the reason for this attack is as a result of the injustices or injustice that's been meted against the Omoku people. So if you say that it is not just for the quest of the injustice, but rather for selfish purpose, how do we explain that?
No. Of course, if you talk about, all of us are doing advocacy. For instance, I told you how my people in Igbo Eche, you know, from Umeblu to Igbo Eche, can't access their communities, having over 350 oil and gas wells. So should I, you know, take up arms? Should I recruit, you know, militants to take up arms to blow up the Obibo oil field that Hess Holdings has been able to take over from SPDC, because my communities have not been developed and all that? No, we continue to do strong advocacy, and that is where, when you begin to challenge, you know, the level of development, and then you come with equity, you come with clean hands and all that, and begin to challenge, you know, some of the things that are there. And so it's not about what the people are doing, you know. Genuinely, we are committed to fighting the cause of the Niger Delta. We must continue the advocacy, you know, in that regard, you know, not in taking up arms, you know, against you know, our own, the facilities that we need to feed from and all that. And so no matter how genuine anybody wants to look at this matter, you know, if it does not come from a legal point of view of advocacy and all that, we continue the advocacy. After all, some of our sons and daughters have been saddled with the responsibility of being in the affairs of NDDC. How have we been able to utilize those resources in developing our people? And so it to vent our anger, is it by blowing up the oil wells and all that? No, it is to consider the advocacy until we get things right.
All right, Professor Nweke, but specifically now the leader of the group, one Agaba, is saying that they want Ajib Oikabdi to commence dealing directly with individual communities other than through individuals. It leads to the question here, would you really say that the issue is with the NDDC and its operations, that some communities are not actually getting the impact of maybe the development that they should ordinarily be getting, or what exactly are the issues?
Let me tell you a simple example. SPDC, for instance, that I know very well, including the Ajib oil company, Total Energy and others, they've been saddled with the responsibilities of developing their those whole communities. But again, all their efforts ought to be complementary in nature, you know, and of course, the government at all levels, including the local government, the state government, the federal government, ought to take a lead in the development of these communities. But what we find in the contrary is the oil companies taking the center seat. Oil companies, for instance, cannot do my 11.6 kilometer from Mobibo end to Igboche end, of course, because they pay their taxes, their royalties. They also support NDDC through the statutory budget provisions and all that. And so they also are saddled with the responsibility of corporate social responsibility to this community. So if the development interventionist and development agencies are doing what they ought to do, and then, of course, the oil companies' efforts in this regard, in their CSR, will complement this effort. But rather than get this, we are getting something in contrary. And so these communities are not developed and as much as they should and all that. And so everybody can leverage on this level of injustice to perpetuate any criminality. That is the point I'm making here.
All right, well said. But then again, they're actually calling for openness, transparency in all of this. They say they want everyone.
And of course, you know that the CIA is in place. And,
yes, it
and
is.
They're going from next year. The communities will be saddled with the responsibility of developing their areas and all that. And so, you know, anybody who is not okay with some of these things should be able to have, you know, some everything in this regard and to give some level of patience because. Very soon, the communities will take charge of the development of their area. And then, of course, we'll see how things pan out there.
Mm. But in all of this, do you think, because we also know that recently the issue of derivation has actually been up, and the fact that some people are saying 13% is not enough, and others are saying, okay, how can host communities just have, you know, about 3%? So that argument back and forth is still ongoing. But another argument is also that, I mean, the resources that has been allocated to this region, how far have we, you know, managed it? What have we done with it? So in all of this, how would you, you know, rate the assessment and the performance of the NNDC in all of this, and how the governors of this region have actually utilized the resources to develop the region?
Yeah, clearly the 13% derivation fund ought to apply to the host community. But what do you see that happen? You know, the governors of these oil-rich states are not also developing along these lines. They are not developing communities along these lines. So if they do with the 13%, you know, these problems would have been reduced. If NDDC also goes by that along this line, these problems should have been reduced. Then if the communities that are given funds, like for SPDC operation, Global Memorandum of Understanding, are also doing what they ought to do, you know, in terms of genuinely committed to the cause of their people, you know, without one or two persons, you know, taking advantage, you know, these communities would have been beehive of development. But that is not the case here. The place I've been mentioning to you in my own community, you know, that we have over 350 oil wells. You know, the state is not also doing anything to address, you know, the just 11.6 kilometer roads. I need a trailer to access that area in Igboche and all that. And so if we use the 13% derivation fund, then we would have turned that place to something else. And then they come in to also complement that. And then with the little that the oil multinationals are also doing, then we would have realized very huge development in the area. But there is complacency, you know, at all levels of government, you know, in joining forces with the oil multinationals in developing our people. And to make it worse, our people are also not helping ourselves. We are not helping ourselves because when we have positions that we need to, you know, act swiftly in developing our areas, we tend to, you know, corner the resources, you know, at our own very advantages rather than, you know, fighting for the cause of the people.
So as it is right now, how do we begin to calm nerves around that particular access, not just only for Omoku community, but across several communities in that room, because they are threatening, that's the Bayan men, they are threatening more attacks in the coming days in that particular region. What should we be saying to them? Are we supposed to bring them to a round table for discussions, or what exactly?
There's nothing like roundtable except that you bring the people of Niger Delta. The people of Niger Delta region need to sit together and tell ourselves the truth. Both those who have served in those capacities in NDDC and those who have saddled with the responsibility of governing this state at all levels of government need to gather together and let us look at our eyes, eye to eye, and tell ourselves the truth and how we need to help the region. That is the only way out of it, and not to discuss with a few section of the people and others. That will not guarantee the much desired peace that we need in the Niger Delta region.
So, but do you think that that's going to bring, a lasting solution to the issue? Because it feels like,
when every stakeholder sits, in the room, lock ourselves, both government, NGOs, these communities, let's tell ourselves we should both pass, current leaders, past and other, let's do some kind of in-house cleaning. Let's tell ourselves the truth, and then, because our people have been saddled with the responsibilities of rural areas, and they have failed in doing so. Let's look at our, faces, and then see how we can, get out of the woods, because nobody else will develop our place apart from ourselves. And we will gather together as a people. The state governors and others need to, in conjunction with some stakeholders in the Niger Delta, need to convene an emergency, stakeholder meeting, and let us discuss our affairs and tell ourselves the truth and tell ourselves the way forward in developing the Niger Delta region. Because without the governors who have this 13% in their hands, and then without other major stakeholders who are part and parcel of the NDDC, and then other stakeholders in the oil industry, we cannot make any headway in terms of genuinely developing the Niger Delta region.
All right, Professor Nweke, do you have enough faith in the fact that the PIA, the recently passed the centered PIA, that's the Petroleum Industry Act, will actually address all of these issues of derivation and, of course, attacks and different communities having some sort of grouse or the other?
Of course, that will not happen. That will not happen. PIA is just addressing a little of it. What we are saying is the 13% derivation. Let those who are holding 13%, identify these communities first, give them priority in terms of development. Then let NDDC also identify these communities and give them priority attention. Then, of course, these would be complemented by the CRS of the multinational. Of course, this will address the challenges so that anybody you can be able to separate criminality from justice and all that. And that's the only way. Because for me, the PIA is merely addressing how communities will get some funds and develop the area. So how much will they get? And then, for instance, the money we get in Igueche address, this 11.6-kilometer road that I'm talking about? The answer is no. So you need the state government who have the 13% funds to first identify the communities that are impacted, and then develop along the line. Local governments in these areas need to also identify these communities and develop them along this line. Then NDDC needs to also do so, while all of these will be complemented by the activities of the multinational.
So at this point, don't you think we should be having conversation regarding resource control? Maybe it's time that the entire federation begin to consider the issue of resource control, and that will solve the issue of injustices that people are agitated about.
When we talk about resource control, a lot of people will also dominate against the masses. So it will be a government of the few against the majority of the people, even in terms of the ego resource control. So when you talk about resource control, the governors of this region will be entrusted with the funds, coming from this region. And so if they have not been able to utilize it, 13% in developing my own community that has over 350 oil wells, then if you talk about resource control, then they can run everybody at camp. So it's not about resource control, it's about genuinely committed in developing the area jointly, and not about resource control. Because resource control will give some people more privilege than the people who are suffering the activities of the oil multinational.
All right, we'll leave up the conversation at that. We understand that you need to take a flight. We must say a very big thank you to you, Professor Nweke, for joining us to bring some, input and, of course, solutions to this militancy in the Niger Delta. We do appreciate your time.
And we wish you a safe flight.
Thank you.
All right, it is The Breakfast on PLUS TV Africa. We'll take a quick break and return with more to join us again.